Apartheid. It has ripped different ethnicities into different groups, unequal and completely divided. Man against man, race against race, violence erupted into the cities of South Africa. Children were left to fend for themselves, alone on the violent streets of South African cities.
Living in South Africa at that time, it was not uncommon to find that one of your loved ones had been killed. The years 1948 to 1994 were years of grief and despair. In this time, murders, massacres, mutilations, suicide attempts, and robberies were common. South Africa needed help.
Help came in the form of an intelligent South African native, Steve Biko.
Having been born on December 18, 1946, apartheid was something Steve had seen and knew well. Opposition of the South African government, referred to as the system, would be key in stopping the implementation of apartheid, and for this opposition to occur, South Africa would be in need of an unforeseen political activist.
There is far more political talk now, far more political debate, and far more condemnation of the system from average black people than there have ever been since possibly 1960 and before.
He founded SASO, a political organization for students. Steve Biko traveled all over the southern countries of Africa, giving speeches and lectures to the inhabitants of apartheid-dominant countries.
So that for meaningful change to occur, there needs to be an attempt at reorganizing the whole economic pattern and economic policies within this particular country.
He wrote various books concerning the predicaments of South Africa and its apartheid-driven government. He preached for the concept of black consciousness. His followers abided black consciousness by taking pride in being black. Biko was also well known for saying black is beautiful. These two notions helped motivate and raise the self-esteem of many blacks.
The black man is well able and the white man knows it.
Steve Biko's leadership and nonviolent actions can be closely compared to the ideas of Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr., who was, at the time, fighting for civil rights back in the United States.
As SASO flourished under Biko's command, Biko formed more organizations which were for adults as well as students. He was a founder of the Black People's Convention, which brought together around 70 black consciousness groups.
I personally would like to see less groups. I'd like to see groups like ANC, PAC, and the Black Consciousness Movement deciding to form one liberation group. And it is only, I think, when black people are so dedicated and so united in their cause that we can effect the greatest results.
Because of his success in leadership and the bringing about of unity between different organizations, Biko was banned by the South African government. His banning included the following restrictions. He was prohibited from leaving the magisterial district of King Williamstown. He was under constant police surveillance. He had periodic police reports. Association with a group of two or more individuals was banned. Visitation to public areas was limited. And conclusively, the bannee could not be quoted. But this was not the end of Biko's political career. Secretly, he continued to speak against apartheid. However, Biko didn't get away with this forever, as Nico Sanathi Biko, his now grown-up son, explains.
Well, my father was arrested in 1977 on August 18th, coming back from a trip in Cape Town, where he had set out to bring about unity between the various political formations, the African National Congress, the Black Consciousness Movement, the Pan-Africanist Congress, and the New Unity Movement. On his way back, he was arrested at a roadblock and taken into custody.
As said by his close friend Donald Woods in his book Biko, Bantu Stephen Biko was taken by the South African political police to room 619 of the Sanlam building in Strand Street, Port Elizabeth, Cape Province, where he was handcuffed, put into leg irons, chained to a grill, and subjected to 22 hours of interrogation, in the course of which he was tortured and beaten, sustaining several blows to the head, which fatally damaged his brain, causing him to lapse into a coma.
On September 11th, his condition had deteriorated to such an extent that he was transported over a journey of 1,000 kilometers in a police van without medical escort, and in the condition that he was, and he died on September 12th.
A cunning lie was allotted by the South African government. James Thomas Kruger, the Minister of Police, claimed that Biko had died due to a hunger strike. However, many who were close to Biko highly doubted this statement, including Biko's wife, Nitsiki Biko.
Well, even if it were he was on hunger strike, I don't think it would have killed him. Yes, especially, you know, quoting the number of days they say he was refusing food.
To prove this suspicion, Donald Woods sought Biko's body in a morgue and took pictures of his injuries. It was obvious that Biko's injuries were not caused by a lack of food, but by violent beatings. On September 25th, 1977, the funeral commenced. Because of police restrictions, thousands of people were unable to attend. Even so, diplomats from many Western countries, as well as natives to South Africa, attended to make the assembly a total of around 20,000 people.
The sorrow of the black Africans was overwhelming. Not only had they lost a valiant leader, they also lost an intriguing friend. The ambition of Steve Biko was not something that could be recreated, and it will be sorely missed, not only in South Africa, but throughout the whole world.
Because of Steve Biko's untimely death and his widely attended funeral, many countries became aware of South Africa's dilemma. Seemingly unsighted before, these Western countries would no longer turn a blind eye on the dire need of South Africa.
The United States, who were on relatively good terms with South Africa, demanded that an inquiry be made about the exact events surrounding Biko's death, or else friendly relations would end. Many European countries were infuriated by the death of an incredibly great man. They questioned the stability and proceedings of South Africa. If South Africa didn't change, it would be left to fend for itself. It seemed that the death of Biko was bringing about more chaos to the government, rather than silence from the public.
Due to the pressure South Africa was bearing from international and national attention, the government had to change their story to something more plausible. An inquest into Biko's death reported that the death was caused by brain damage. The news story was that Biko was accidentally killed by the security police due to unmanageable behavior.
Donald Woods attempted to leave the country with his evidence that Biko did indeed die from police abuse. In response, the government banned him in order to keep the truth from being let out amongst the public. As South Africa became too dangerous for Woods, he left the country with his wife and five children. He published a book about Biko, containing the truth of his death and the pictures to prove it. Because of this, the truth of Biko's death was soon discovered by people all over the world. Due to the brutality of Biko's death, he became a symbol of black opposition.
By the formation of many organizations and his death as a martyr, Stephen Bantu Biko aroused thousands to fight for equal rights, which eventually resulted in the end of the apartheid in South Africa.
I think that he was very instrumental in redefining the way we viewed ourselves as a nation. I think that he spoke a lot about the need for black people to be central in defining and articulating their own aspirations, and that nobody was going to lead them out of the oppression that they were under.
Because of Steve Biko's active participation in the political field, South Africa is a very different place today. The end of apartheid came in the year 1994, and in that same year, South Africa elected a black president, Nelson Mandela. Mandela had been elected in South Africa's first fully represented democratic election. Had Steve Biko lived to see this day, he would have seen a South Africa that he had always dreamed of. Because of his nonviolent outlook on political actions, he has been able to bring about hope and unity to the black South Africans. Black has shown itself, through Steve Biko's leadership, to be just as good as white. And black, in the words of a very important South African native, is beautiful.